Good evening, everybody. I'm John Levy. I'm the 10th chair of the board of directors of the Legal Services Corporation. And what a pleasure it is on behalf of our board to welcome you to this Access to Justice and Pro Bono Awards reception. Tonight, we recognize six distinguished Arizona jurists for their exemplary pro bono contributions to LSC's three grantees in the state. You know them well, I'm sure, Community Legal Services, DNA People Legal Services, and Southern Arizona Legal Aid, and we just heard from them, and what an impressive group of dedicated, really dedicated executive directors and their lawyers and paraprofessionals that work with them. We will be privileged also to hear remarks on access to justice issues from the leaders of Arizona's legal community, including Arizona's Supreme Court Vice Chief Justice Ann Timmer, Judge Samuel Thumma of the Arizona Court of Appeals, and Dr. Kevin Ruegg, CEO, Executive Director of the Arizona Foundation for Legal Services and Education. And we will also hear from the University of Arizona College of Law Dean Marc Miller. Well, Arizona is one of those states, you know it better than we do, that's leading the nation in regulatory reform of the profession in an effort to help close the justice gap. And our speakers tonight are at the forefront of that effort. I also want to acknowledge Chair Henry Sue, a partner with the Bradley firm, and other dedicated members of the American Bar Association Standing Committee on Pro Bono and Public Service who are here with us this evening as they continue their recent tradition of holding their January meeting concurrently with ours. Do you want to say a couple of, Henry, and I'll come back in a second.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, thanks to John and the Legal Services Corporation Board for inviting me and my fellow committee members as guests. I'm glad to celebrate with you these outstanding pro bono contributors in your state. When I think about the access to justice gap, I know that when I come to a state like Arizona, I can say that it's not a gap, right? It's a chasm or a canyon. It's incredibly big, large, and to actually bridge that gap starts with you and me as individual lawyers, each doing our part to promote access to justice. And every year my committee celebrates five individuals and organizations at our ABA annual meeting with their annual pro bono public awards. But I always come away from that selection process thinking, five awards is just not enough to cover this large country and to recognize all the great things that people are doing in our 50 states and territories. So I'm glad to be here to celebrate the winners tonight, and so congratulations to everyone. Thanks, John.
And well, I realized you have one of the also very distinguished members of the American Bar Association leadership, Trish Rifo. Where are you, Trish? Oh, there you are. These awards reflect LSC's significant commitment to pro bono service, evidenced by our pro bono task force, most recently by our Pro Bono Innovation Fund grants program, which supports projects that develop replicable innovations in pro bono service for low-income clients. A few months ago, LSC announced its grants in pro bono for 2022, totaling $4.75 million to 15 legal aid organizations. That program has now awarded 121 grants of $35 million since in the last 10 years. And as we and you work hard to promote pro bono, we together have to acknowledge that pro bono is most effective when supported by adequately funded, properly structured legal aid programs that screen the cases, support the volunteer lawyers with training, materials, and the expertise of staff attorneys and paraprofessionals. But the chronic, serious underfunding of OSC undermines not only the delivery of legal aid service, but the effective provision of pro bono services as well. So as grateful as we are that the omnibus spending bill passed recently, just a few weeks ago by Congress, increased OSC's funding to $560 million, a 14.5% hike. Much more is needed to meet the massive unmet legal needs of low-income Americans after years of inadequate resourcing. In fiscal year 1994, 28 years ago, our appropriation was $400 million. By 2022, our appropriation was just $489 million. Well, that doesn't keep up with inflation, much less the increased demand, need for services resulting from recessions, population growth, disasters, the pandemic that have occurred in the last three decades. In fact, when the LSC board was last here in Arizona in 2010, our congressional funding was only $420 million. So that's why our board unanimously voted to seek $1.5 billion from Congress for fiscal year 2024. With that level of funding, pro bono lawyers working in conjunction with lawyers at OSC-funded programs will be able to help thousands more people across the country and play an even greater role in OSC's mission to help ensure equal access to justice. That pro bono service reflects a fundamental responsibility of our profession. As Arizona's gift to the United States Supreme Court, Justice Sandra Day O'Connor once observed, and I quote her, "Public service marks the difference between a business and a profession. While a business can afford to focus solely on profits, a profession cannot. It must devote itself first to the community it is responsible to serve. I can imagine no greater duty than fulfilling this obligation. And I can imagine no greater pleasure," unquote. Well, this evening, we honor Arizona lawyers who have responded to this greater duty. And thank you very much. And now we will move to our speakers. And it's my great privilege to introduce the Vice Chief Justice of your state, Ann A. Scott Timmer. She was appointed. I got to hear her the other day. I told her she's a rock star. She is, because she's been serving on the Arizona Supreme Court since her appointment in 2012 by Governor Brewer, and prior to that, she was a judge on the Court of Appeals here from 2000 to 2012, serving for 3 years as its chief judge. But she has been such a leader in the effort to expand justice in Arizona. She served as a chair of the Task Force on Delivery of Legal Services that examined how the state could overhaul ways it regulates the legal profession to better meet the needs of Arizonans. And in 2021, Arizona became the first state to eliminate the ban on non-lawyer ownership of law firms. Her efforts to expand access to justice have been recognized by the ABA Journal, the American Bar Association Center. She's a graduate of the University of Arizona, has her JD from Arizona State, and a master in judicial studies from Duke University Law School. Thank you for being with us, Justice Timmer.
Thank you. Well, good evening and welcome to Arizona. Thank you so much for the very kind introduction, John. His words reminded me when he spoke of Justice O'Connor, it gave rise to, in my mind, to another quote of hers that I have a t-shirt that says it, work worth doing. And that reminds me of really all of you here today. You do work worth doing, absolutely. When I was practicing law, I was on the board, I was telling someone for several years at Community Legal Services. So I know how hard you work. I know you really do fight the good fight. And I applaud all of you and celebrate you for doing that work and keep it up as well. What I thought I would speak to you today, I was asked to speak about, is some of the legal reforms that we've made in Arizona. As John said, I chaired the task force. I asked to chair that task force because it was a great opportunity to really dig into some of these issues and see what we could do. One of the benefits of being on the Supreme Court, besides, of course, deciding cases, is frankly the ability to influence the direction that the judiciary and the practice of law go. There's seven of us on the court, and to have a voice to be able to direct some of that effort is really a privilege that I'm grateful to hold. What were we guided by? Well, the entire court was, I have to read this part, guided really by the ethical rule preamble, paragraph 12. It says the profession has a responsibility to assure that its regulations are conceived in the public interest and not in the furtherance of parochial or self-interested concerns of the bar. This obligation is one, as a regulator, the Arizona Supreme Court takes very seriously. It's also one that spurred then-Chief Justice Scott Bales to form the task force that looked into many things that in our ethical rules, but of interest to this group tonight, of course, is could non-lawyers provide legal services? Should they? And if so, how? And should we allow lawyers to innovate and expand their practices through our ethical rules, which really defines our market of how lawyers are entitled to practice. So all of us in this room are generally aware, of course, of the ever-growing gap in accessing civil justice in our country. And the evidence presented to the task force bore this out and suggested several reasons for it. So for one, of course, on the commission, and I'm sure you all know, the Commission on the Future of Legal Services report in 2016 said that well over 100 million Americans are living with civil justice problems, including those involving housing, child custody, proceedings, and debt collections. And it's not difficult really to explain why. We found that the cost of hiring lawyers since the 1970s has just grown exponentially. And what we found, and mostly through the works of people like Professor Bill Henderson from Indiana, who has made a great study of this and kindly came out to us. Thank you, Indiana. most law firms have done pretty darn well since the 1970s, and that's great because we want lawyers to be successful, right? But where they're getting their monies from increasingly are from entities, companies, people who can afford to pay some of the hefty fees that are charged, at least hefty from a person's perspective. But what about regular people? Professor Henderson calls this the people law sector. Who is taking care of the people law sector? And increasingly, it's not law firms. So we have that. So who are taking care of people? Well, they're the small law firms, and they're the solo practitioners, the people who do general work in your small towns. Well, what's happening with them? Well, they're not thriving as they used to. Increasingly, there's a great deal of competition from the do-it-yourself folks that you can now, especially can go online, to do your articles of incorporation, your wills, your trusts, the bread and butter of many practices. That work has been going away. For these folks. So, for example, in 2016, Clio, which is something that makes this online cloud-based billing services that many people use, surveyed its customers. They got responses from over 60,000 lawyers who reported that they really aren't billing much time, collecting even less of it, I think 1.6 hours a day, and making on average $422 a day. That adds up to $105,000 gross a year if they worked, assuming a two-week vacation and before they pay taxes or overhead. Those lawyers are not thriving. Why do we care about those lawyers? Because those are the people, as I said, that are representing regular people. So we certainly have an interest in Arizona to ensuring that those lawyers can thrive. They need to be able to compete with some of the online services. So that was part of the reason we were looking into, should we allow more innovation with how they practice? So what's going on in the courts? Well, the courts increasingly are inundated with pro per representation and having difficulties in kind of straddling that line between we're not supposed to help people, on the other hand, you need to make sure people can get through the court system. We've done what we can ever since I've been in the judiciary for 23 years now. You see the proliferation of self-help and forms and online forms and navigators and such. And those are laudable, that what the courts have done, but it's certainly not enough. It's become really a drop in the bucket. So as a result of this backdrop, what the court decided to do is that we needed to do something a little more bold, if you will. And as long as we can be assured that the public would be safely represented and not a danger to the public, we felt confident that we could take these steps. So the two big things we did is we eliminated ER 5.4, which is the rule that says that lawyers and non-lawyers cannot share fees. From our perspective, we looking back historically, it looked like that rule was initially put into place back in sometime in the 1920s, and purportedly from the fear, according to some academics, by lawyers that banks would start hiring lawyers to represent. And so they didn't want the competition. That rule has morphed, I think, into securing people's belief, at least, that rule is needed to secure the independence of lawyers, client confidentiality, and conflicts of interest. But as we looked at it, there's a whole bunch of other ethical rules that accomplish just that. So what we decided to do is eliminate the rule. We beefed up some others that actually make it a little bit more onerous and on lawyers to respect the three things that I just mentioned. And the world has not come to a shattering end. Who knew? The practice of law is still fine. Lawyers are still doing pretty darn well. And what we've done is that because we're eliminated the rule, that if you do go into practice with a lawyer and a non-lawyer, that you will become what's called an alternative business structure. And that is regulated by the Arizona Supreme Court. As most of you know, law firms aren't regulated by the court. Lawyers are. But now we regulate entities. And so if you have an alternative business structure, you have to go through and get the permission of, comes right up to the seven of us to decide after it's vetted if they could safely operate. There's a rule, there's a code of ethics, there's discipline, there's real consequences to any violations. And so far it's worked fine. I think we have somewhere around 30 now, and people are starting to innovate more with how they deliver services to clientele. The second thing that we did, of course, was we've now licensed what we call legal paraprofessionals. We don't call them legal paralegals because the ABA said, please don't call them paralegals because we have a division and we didn't want to cause problems. We actually spent more time about how to name these people than anything. But we came up with legal paraprofessionals. So they're licensed by the court. They have educational requirements. They have experiential requirements. They have a testing requirement. They then become affiliate members of the bar. They have the same type of background check, discipline code, discipline system that the lawyers do in Arizona. Now, they are not like lawyers. They do practice law, but they do not practice law anywhere they'd like to go. They are limited to particular subject matter areas, and their experience, their education, their testing are all confined to those areas. And the areas that have been identified thus far that we allow are three of which you really don't see lawyers too often. Limited jurisdiction courts, which in Arizona are our city courts and our justice of the peace courts, in civil matters, so that would be less than $12,000 at issue, and in criminal matters, as long as jail time is not involved. So you really aren't seeing lawyers too much in those areas. We also allow it for administrative agencies, as long as the agencies themselves permit it, which is really not too different from what goes on now. With like the IRS, you don't have to be an attorney to represent someone. But now this puts a structure and a regulatory framework around that type of practice. The fourth area, you do see attorneys, and that's been a little more controversial, which is family law. So family law in Maricopa County, where you're currently sitting, when we had our task force, we looked at what was going on there. Somewhere around 95% of the cases had at least one unrepresented party, and 75% had both unrepresented. So there's plenty of room in there for lawyers who practice that area to also have licensed paraprofessionals. And as I've told the family law lawyers, you can make money at this. You can expand your practice by hiring these people and deploying them for cases that you ordinarily would not have taken. And that's what's happened. So as far as has it been successful, so far so good. Time will tell. It's been 2 years. I was telling someone earlier that I was two superior court judges or trial level judges approached me at a conference to tell me that they had trials with paraprofessionals conducted, and they did an excellent job, better than most attorneys that they see. Because these are now the paralegals who were very experienced family law paralegals are getting licensed. So that's where we are so far in Arizona. And I should tell you that since we're having the pro bono awards, that one of the figures that stuck out in my mind always is that it would take, we're told by an ABA commission, 900 hours for every practicing attorney in the U.S. to make any type of impact on starting to close the access to justice gap in the civil arena. 900. I think I applaud all the lawyers, especially the ones here today, who do this terrific work. It really is, God's work that you're doing. But it's not fair to expect that our problems are going to be solved on the backs of attorneys. The problems that we have are ones that the justice system needs to take on, but frankly, so does the entire nation needs to take on and start addressing this of how to close that gap. So, in my view, it's time for bold measures. Arizona's taken those steps thus far. Time will tell how it will work out, and time will tell if others will follow. But thank you so much for your attention tonight.
Wow. Judge Tim, Trish and I would like, where's Trish? She just walked out. Trish and I want to enlist your support for a conversation with the ABA House of Delegates. A little education would go a long way there. My name is Robert Gray. I am a member of the board of LSC. I am delighted to be here. Thank you for the hospitality. This is a wonderful opportunity for us to visit with you and those who are stalwarts and pillars of the legal community here, and to all those people who are being recognized tonight, congratulations, and thank you for all that you do. I wanted to say one thing, but Trish walked out, so I'm going to say it anyway. When I was president of the ABA, my initiative was better justice through better juries. The person that was the chair of the honorary chair of this initiative was Sandra Day O'Connor. And somebody said, you should call her to ask her if she would chair it. I said, you want me to call her? She said, yeah, you call her. I called her. And her assistant said, you want to talk to the justice? I said, yes. I'm president of the ABA. And she said, good. I'll take your name and I'll see if I can get you an appointment. She took the appointment, and I went to visit her. And when I walked into her chambers, she said, President Gray. I said, Justice O'Connor. She said, have a seat. I know why you're here. The answer is yes. What else you want to talk about? Golf? She's good. She did everything we asked her to do. She showed up at DC District Superior Court and impaneled a jury that day. And we had CNN and C-SPAN and everybody there. And the jurors were just flabbergasted. They were sitting there going, yeah, I promise I'll say everything. She was great. Trish Rifo was the chair of the operating or the working committee in that we used to modify the principles of service on juries. And Judith Kay, who was the chief judge of the Court of New York, was the working chair of the commission. So I had two Arizonans and a New Yorker, three women running my initiative. And you know what? We upgraded the standards on juries. We put it before the House of Delegates. It passed on a voice vote. It did help to say that Justice O'Connor had agreed that these were good, and it worked well. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to recognize those who are doing such great work. One of the privileges I get is to introduce another judge. And while we had a rock star first, we've got a superstar second. And Judge Thumma is, as you know, is on the Arizona Court of Appeals for Division I, and he has been there since 2012, including 2 years as chief judge. So previously he served where Judge O'Connor served on the Arizona Superior Court, Maricopa County, and he has served as an elected member of the executive committee and chairs the Arizona Commission on Access to Justice, and we were just talking about that. So thank you for that service and all the other positions that you've held with Uniform Law Commission, American Law Institute, American Bar Association, and the National Center for State Courts. It is nice when the Supreme Court recognizes you as the judge of the year. Judge Thumma was recognized as judge of the year by the Arizona Supreme Court in 2021. Iowa State University produced an outstanding quarterback that we're all watching today. But before he came along, Judge Thumma went there. And so we are proud to tell you that he is a graduate of Arizona State University, Iowa College of Law, and Duke University School of Law. The one thing that you may not know about Judge Thumma is that as part of his college matriculation, he spent the summer studying to be an auctioneer. So he graduated, he got his license, he was hired, and he was crying sales as a part of his cultural development as a lawyer. And I'm sure it has served him well. I can imagine him on the bench saying, "That objection, I'm not sure about, but it's going once, going twice." Overruled. Judge Thumma, thank you.
Robert, thank you. Thank you so much. And let me start, as I will end, by thanking you all. There are many other places you could be tonight. There are many other things you could do with your time. There are many other things that could cause the stomach acid to churn. But you're here, and you're doing the right thing, and you're trying to help people in need, and that's pretty special. So thank you. I am chair of the Arizona Commission on Access to Justice, started by administrative order, by the Arizona Supreme Court in 2014. Our mission and vision is to improve lives by working to promote and expand civil legal services in Arizona and by collaborating, educating, improving, and advocating for access to civil justice for all. We have 24 members. We have fabulous staff. I'm delighted to report that representatives of Arizona Legal Service Corporation entities are actively involved in our commission, and we are so much better for it. Let me thank you to the Legal Services Corporation for supporting DNA People's Legal Services, Southern Arizona Legal Aid, and Community Legal Services right here in our backyard. They are three of 132 legal service or legal aid programs that LSC supports. You have chosen wisely. You have invested well. Thank you. Thank you for supporting us here in Arizona. And let me offer a year early congratulations on LSC's 50th anniversary coming up next year. Thank you for making our world a better place. It means a lot. So I was given between 5 and 7 minutes with the remainder of my time to address, and I'll read it here, how we might close the justice gap in America. So I'll use the rest of my time sort of hopefully wisely. And Robert, thank you so much again for your service and for that overly kind introduction. But I have no single solution. Let me set expectations. I'm not going to have you leave here with a mortal consciousness. If I did and could, I'd share it with you, I promise. And then I'd get on a boat and sail off in the sunset, and life would be better for us all. But let me share what I think are three behaviors that can help. And I guarantee everyone in this room has each of these three. First one, a desire to help those in need, right? And that's a human condition sort of thing. I'm reading some papers by C.S. Lewis on some addresses he made for the BBC during World War II, right as it was beginning. And he talks about kind of that mindset, that's a human intuition to try to help other people, crosses cultures, crosses all sorts of barriers. So let's just assume that everybody in this county, in this state, in this country wants to help those in need. Far less people than have that want actually act on it, right? And so that brings me to my second point. Along with the desire to help those in need, to take action to help those in need. And that's not only to help people that you see, but help mentor people who are looking to you to see what's right and what's not. And that can be a child, that can be a coworker, that can be someone who's your senior, right? There's no corner on that market. But it also motivates. And when someone sees you do good to help someone who will never repay you, never can repay you, that pays things forward in ways that only the heart can appreciate. So let me suggest that's the second one. You know, want to help people and then actually acting on helping people. And then the third point, the third quality I'd suggest is a modest sense of urgency. It is easy to want to help people and say, I will take action tomorrow. I will take action next week. I will take action when I earn more money. I will take action when I have more time. I will take action when our daughter goes to college, right? But the hard thing, and the thing that all of you do, is you do it now. And you don't do it because it's easy. And you don't necessarily do it because somebody's watching, although you know someone is. But you do it because you think it's the right thing. That's special. Keep doing what you're doing. Thank you for all you do to help people, regardless of whether they may even know it, regardless of whether you're quite sure whether it's helping or not. But thank you for everything you do. Thank you, Legal Services Corporation. And I'm so excited to honor these volunteer lawyers. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Judge Thumma, for those remarks. Very much. My name's Lori Mikva. I'm a member of the LSC board and from Chicago. It's my pleasure to introduce Marc Miller, Dean, and Ralph W. Bilby, Professor of Law at the University of Arizona College of Law. He's the author of more than 70 articles on a wide range of topics: environmental, criminal justice, immigration, and legal theory. He co-founded the Federal Sentencing Reporter, the leading journal on sentencing law and policy. Dean Miller previously taught at Emory University Law School, where he served as Associate Dean for Faculty and Scholarship. Before teaching, Dean Miller served as law clerk to Chief Judge John Godbold of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit, as attorney advisor in the Office of Legal Counsel of the U.S. Department of Justice, and a special counsel at the Vera Institute of Justice in New York. He's a graduate of Pomona College and a law school I'm proud to claim as my hometown, University of Chicago Law School. Thank you for joining us today, Dean Miller.
So I want to tell you a little bit about what we do at the University of Arizona to expose our students to LSC and its work, to the importance of pro bono services, and more broadly, to access to justice issues. But in the world of connections and history, I'm just going to take one moment to start with a personal reflection. I met John Levy in person for the first time this evening, and we spoke only a few weeks ago for the first time digitally. But his father met me when I was 1 week old in Chicago. The connections are deep. There are only two law schools in the state. They're both public, they're both excellent. I think exposing students broadly to the access to justice gap is an unmet challenge. And you may think the fundamental challenge is providing legal services, but if we don't graduate lawyers who appreciate the challenge, whatever their individual path is, it's harder to get them to support the critical issues of funding, of time, and to build the community structures to deliver legal services. So we start, we're small law school, at a big university. We start the very first day students show up with conversations around what does it mean to be a professional. We have judges and lawyers come in and break into small groups. And every one of those first year students on their very first day is engaged with a set of hypotheticals, a set of questions about the lawyer's role and the lawyer's obligation. We try through first year classes, including a class we call Prepared to Practice. We try and set some foundations beyond what is delivered in the normal JD classroom and sustain that discussion of professionalism. Celebrate as students work with lawyers to learn about pro bono services, go to work with the three great legal aid organizations who provide much mentoring and training in this state. Beyond that, we've tried to confront the question of thinking about the access gap that has been mentioned several times by Justice Timmer and others by pushing to create an entirely new program and paradigm, not one that is inconsistent with public funding for civil legal services, certainly not inconsistent with pro bono, but adds to it. It's called Innovation for Justice. I know my colleague, Professor Stacy Butler, spoke at this conference, and some of you may have heard that. The idea is to train a wide number of lawyers to think differently about the access to justice problem. Now, we set a foundation for that some time ago by providing a much broader base of who is trained to work in legal and regulated settings. We started the first BA in law in the country. Can a bachelor's graduate be licensed to practice? Well, before the legal paraprofessionals existed, the answer was no. But as we went around and surveyed both public and private actors, managing and hiring partners, legislators, general counsel, in-house counsel, and so forth, and asked how many people who worked in their offices were not lawyers, it was often a majority. And we asked what was their background. English, political science, art, opera, I don't know, everything. But what if people were trained to work in legal and regulated settings? Would that be of interest? And the universal answer we got was yes. We also knew this would be an engine to diversifying the profession, which we thought would connect not only to a commitment to a broader range of legal services, but respond to a huge need and challenge for those of us who ultimately train licensed attorneys. That major currently has 1,700 students in it, the significant majority female, the majority diverse, and half who self-identify as first-generation students. About 40%. So about 40% of those graduates representing that same diversity go on to JD within a couple years. If it was 80%, you'd look at me and say, Marc, that's a pre-law program. You just got a fancy name. It's not. We really are training people to go down a number of paths. We have also a master's degree for non-lawyers. And by the way, if you think the 1,700 number is a little hard to believe, 600 of those are in China, Vietnam, and Cambodia. So if you want to just say, well, how many are in the US, you could, still number is still pretty dramatic. The training of non-lawyers was part of what led our Supreme Court and the committee that Vice Justice Timmer led to think about whether or not there could and would be training for non-lawyers if a category of limited practice was created. And indeed, we were asked, is this something that would interest you? And we were asked about the process. Here we are in a state of north of 7 million people. Everything we've done at the law school would have modest effect, and you could say it was still academic, without a state Supreme Court, which is deeply committed to access issues. Justice Timmer's described two of those. She has the support, and the court has worked as a whole. And for us, that creates an incredibly exciting opportunity to work with the court, to provide this training, and to think in structural ways, sometimes using technology. People often assume it's technology is the answer. No, often not. Often it's rules. Often it's working very closely with judicial and non-judicial organizations. So I wanted to just describe what I think is an important effort on our part to have all of our JD graduates aware of the fundamental challenge of access to justice, many trained in some alternative and additional answers, and then to be training many, a much, much, much larger number of people who can work, some as LPs, within the legal and regulated settings that we hope will provide additional services beyond the incredibly important work of legal aid and pro bono attorneys. Many of you, I expect, have relationships with the law schools that taught you or that are nearby where you work. What we are doing is not common. So if you find what I just said interesting and consistent with the mission of the Legal Services Corporation, let me encourage you to think about engaging the faculty, the students, and the deans at the law schools where you have connections. Thank you for these few moments to talk about what we're doing.
That's a big step up. Good evening, everyone. My name is Father Pius Petrick. I am the vice chair of the Legal Services Corporation. It's wonderful for me to be back. I grew up here in Phoenix. I grew up on the northwest side, 43rd and Peoria. Went to Brophy High School. Worked for several years as a high school and college student at the Arizona Supreme Court in the clerk's office. I love being back in Arizona. And, you know, when I think about the qualities of Arizona, especially when I was young here, one thought about what an Arizonan was. One of the things that would come to mind is a word like independent, which my mother always said was just a nice word for stubborn, but still. Independence is a value that Arizonans pride themselves a great deal, and I think that independence was rooted in a kind of self-reliance. The Arizonan has a history of people who came out here and built things for themselves. And so for an Arizonan to see a problem and to see an issue, it's not to see it as someone else's problem, but what can I do to solve it? How many people sitting in, say, a courtroom, seeing lots of defendants, lots of people who are seeking help, without help, say to themselves, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to start a self-help clinic right here in the courtroom to help these people who need it. Well, the kind of person who does that is Diane Drain. That's the kind of person who does that. She had her own career as a bankruptcy lawyer, still does, and seeing the great need for help for bankruptcy litigants, worked to begin a self-help clinic, which has grown to about a dozen face-to-face attorneys, about 80 attorneys who assist all over the state in providing help to litigants in bankruptcy proceedings. And that's on top of nearly 30 years with the Volunteer Lawyers Program. Not just one avenue for volunteering, but two lifetimes worth of volunteering. And she's not only works herself, she recruits her not quite better half, her husband who assists in what she does. You know, when we were away at COVID, the thing I missed most were these events in which we got to hear the great heroes who have given so much of their time, energy, and expertise to helping those in need. And I think you have in your company, Diane Drain, who is one of the great examples of that. So I'd ask you, Diane, to come forward, and on behalf of Legal Services, accept this award.
So my name is John Malcolm. I'm a member of the board of the Legal Services Corporation. And it's now my privilege to get to say a few words about our next award recipient, Edwin Ramos. Edwin is an attorney and managing partner at the firm of De La Osa and Ramos. After receiving his Bachelor of Science degree at Arizona State University, he worked in the healthcare industry for a while. As the son of immigrants who became naturalized citizens, he was inspired to attend law school and to pursue a career in practicing immigration law. He's volunteered, though, with the Community Legal Services Volunteer Lawyers Program at the children in their children's law clinic since 2016. Although his practice area is indeed, as he hoped it would be, immigration law, he signed up with the children's law clinic to take on minor guardianship cases. And he learned that area so well that he is now considered an expert and actually trains new volunteer attorneys in those cases and in severance and adoption cases. Being bilingual, his services are both a gift and a great comfort for families who speak Spanish and have limited English skills. He also assists the Community Legal Services Medical Legal Partnership at least twice a month by calling applicants and by offering his services. Due to his contributions, he was named the Volunteer Lawyers Program's Medical Legal Partnership Attorney in 2022. Last year alone, he provided more than 200 hours of pro bono legal assistance to Community Legal Services clients. On behalf of the Legal Services Corporation, I'm truly honored to present this pro bono award to Edwin Ramos in recognition for his extraordinary commitment and service.
Good evening. I'm glad to see this crowd here that is interested in who does the pro bono work for your community and to honor and recognize them. I'm Gloria Valencia Weber, and I'm from New Mexico, and I'm going to present the award to David Engelman. As a law professor, I'm always interested in what happens to people when they begin their law careers and then what their views are about their professional and personal life at mature points in their lives. So before this event, I had a brief conversation with Mr. Engelman, and I asked him of the three valuable aspects of his life, what were they that made his life the worthwhile and the productive one that we're going to hear about? He said he really valued that he could have lived his life in accord with his social ideals, with the ideals that he felt earlier in life. And secondly, the wonderful relationships both in and out of law. And thirdly, he knew that he had made some contributions to help people, that it was visible in his own observations. And I think that really helps me understand a lot of how he came to be honored. Mr. Engelman's legal career began 25 years ago as a solo practitioner and 17 years managing a small firm. He is an attorney and shareholder in the Engelman Berger Law Firm, where he focuses on commercial law, including banking, credit, and credit union matters, complex business deals and disputes, and commercial bankruptcy. He also serves as general counsel to the Arizona Federal Credit Union. He has a prolific history of pro bono service. He has volunteered with community legal services for 41 years. That's longer than some of those in the room have of their whole lifetime. There he has provided several thousand volunteer hours and also helped them with establishing clinics. Then in 2022, David came to DNA People's Legal Services, which operates out of the four corners of the state, way beyond the luxuries and the enticements of that urban area outside. He went to train in-house attorneys on handling bankruptcy cases, and he is currently helping the organization establish a bankruptcy clinic. This bankruptcy clinic will allow DNA to better meet one of the Navajo Reservation's areas of greatest need. Through his training and mentorship of DNA's and community legal services attorneys, he has helped many legal aid providers to grow their abilities, to grow their knowledge, and his generous support of these programs have made a wide impact on countless people facing hardship across Arizona. As an Arizona native and one who is connected relationally and in my experience with the people of the Four Corners area, I greatly value what Mr. Engelman has done. So we want to thank David today for his continuing dedication to volunteering, and on behalf of LSC, it is my pleasure to present a pro bono award to David Engelman.
Hi, my name's Abby Kuzma. I'm one of the board members of Legal Services Corporation. I have to say, it's my privilege to be here in Phoenix, and especially because I saw the sun yesterday, which living now in Chicago is a very rare occurrence. So I've really been appreciating that. Callie Rowe is the person that I get to honor. And I just talked with her a little bit of a while ago, and she is incredible, and I really enjoyed meeting her. We actually have a number of things in common, so it was a real special privilege to talk to her. She's a part-time volunteer attorney, an accomplished poet and author. I do not have that in common with her at all. After working as a litigator in private practice and serving in the appellate division of the General Counsel of Securities and Exchange Commission, Kelly stepped back from the workforce to raise a family. In 2016, she returned to the practice of law on a volunteer basis, representing undocumented people, primarily women, filing affirmative petitions with the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services under the Violence Against Women Act, otherwise VAWA, and representing those in removal proceedings in immigration court. Kelly also went on to earn her, and I believe U visa as well, she went on to earn her Master of Fine Arts and author two chapbooks. I had to look that up. I didn't know what a chapbook was. As well as a forthcoming full-length poetry connection. Wow. Kelly has been working with DNA, People's Legal Services, since 2015, putting in over 175 hours of pro bono work. I think the rest of us can take a lot of inspiration from that.
As immigration is a notoriously complicated practice area, it's often difficult to find attorneys who will provide pro bono direct representation on these cases, and I know that firsthand. But she has been steadfastly dedicated to this case and helping her clients lead lives free of domestic violence. She's been working on a case for over 5 years at this point, so it's a very real issue with immigration cases. Due to the complexities of the U.S. immigration system, Kelly has had cases which have lasted for many years. Some of those cases have yet to resolve, but she continues to zealously represent clients for however long their cases are pending. For her unwavering resolve and life-changing service, it's my honor to present Kelly Rowe with this pro bono award.
Good evening. I'm Frank Nooner. I'm the only LSC board member from Louisiana, unlike Chicago, which has several. I have the honor in absentia of introducing and honoring Honorable James Conlogue. Judge James Conlogue spent 26 years on the Cochise County Superior Court, including 8 years as the county's presiding judge. Prior to his tenure in the Superior Court, he worked for the U.S. Navy in Washington, D.C., and then returned to Arizona to join the Cochise County Public Defender's Office, and later opened his own private practice in Bisbee. Judge Conlogue retired from full-time judicial work at the end of 2020 and has quickly become one of the most active volunteer attorneys with Southern Arizona Legal Aid. He has tirelessly served with the Volunteer Lawyers Program, participating in the Family Law Clinic and the Rural Clinic. In less than 2 years, he has held 133 clinics for more than 300 attendees. He's also stepped up to organize an ethics continuing legal education event for attorneys in Cochise County with the goal of encouraging more volunteerism in a rural area. Due to his exceptional dedication to Southern Arizona Legal Aid, he was recognized with their highest award at their October 2022 Volunteer Appreciation Event. He was also recently appointed to the Board of Directors of Southern Arizona Legal Aid and joined the Advisory Committee of the Volunteer Lawyers Program. For all of these reasons, on behalf of the LSC Board, I'm honored and pleased to present this pro bono award to Judge James Conlogue.
Good evening, folks. I'm Vic Maddox. I'm a lawyer in Louisville, Kentucky, and I've been on the board for about 12 years now. So I'm going to introduce our last recipient, who is Benjamin Smith. Seems to have lived many lives before finding his way to the law and earning a JD in his 50s. Previously, he taught philosophy and the history of science and technology at the College of the Atlantic in the state of Maine, and then became involved in a shipbuilding business, and finally worked in archaeology as an editor at the Arizona State Museum. Since then, in legal field, he's developed a passion for volunteer service, dedicating his practice to pro bono work. He began volunteering in the Southern Arizona Legal Aid in 2007, primarily taking on domestic violence cases in their family law clinics. Over about 14 years, SALA estimates that he has assisted approximately 8,700 clients over the course of almost 1,650 clinics and 135 direct representation cases. This is amazing. His clinic hours alone add up to nearly 5,000 hours of pro bono service. He's an invaluable partner to Southern Arizona Legal Aid and the Volunteer Lawyers Program, where he's twice been recognized as Volunteer of the Month for his extraordinary service. He exemplifies the principles of service, generosity, and access to justice for all. On behalf of LSC, it is my honor to present this pro bono award to Benjamin Smith, and I know that the SALA representatives will make sure that the the plaque that we provide is delivered to him. So thank you, Ben Smith. And now I am pleased to introduce Dr. Kevin Ruegg, CEO and Executive Director of the Arizona Bar Foundation. Under Dr. Ruegg's direction for the past 18 years, the foundation strives to provide access to justice for Arizonans most in need and to prepare Arizona youth for civic responsibility. Through the provision of technical and financial assistance to probation and resource officers, teachers and administrators, private attorneys and judges, and legal service attorneys and advocates, the foundation works to level the playing field so that all in Arizona have the knowledge and access to the justice systems. Prior to her tenure at the foundation, Dr. Ruegg was a faculty associate at Arizona State University and served as executive director of Family Housing Advisory Services in Omaha, Nebraska. She holds degrees from the Newman University, Webster University, and Walden University. Thank you for joining us tonight, Dr. Ruegg.
Well, it is good to be here. I am certain that everyone joins me in thanking the Legal Service Corporation for the opportunity to celebrate our pro bono awardees. We've been inspired by their example and by the presentations given this evening. It is good to be here. I've been asked to offer a few thoughts on what pro bono means to Arizona. And I recognize I'm near the close of the agenda, so I will just offer 3 points on how pro bono impacts self, the economy, and our justice system. And I have to tell you, I'm going to have to interrupt myself because I've learned things tonight. And so it changes a little bit of what I was going to say. The first, pro bono impacts on self, on the individual attorney, and thus on the legal profession. We are fortunate in Arizona to have strong volunteer lawyer programs who offer much support to assure successful pro bono experiences. Also in Arizona, our Supreme Court and our state bar each have access to justice as the first goal in their strategic plans. The first goal. I don't know how many of you knew that. I think that's very impressive. Because of this support and focus, Arizona has a plethora of ways an attorney can offer pro bono. They can be online, through the television, in person, in clinics, with brief services, virtually. There are many, many ways assuring that the pro bono work best fits each attorney. With that happening in our state, I was going to say I can attest, but I actually asked David Engelman, and he's got 41 years, and he said I was right. So I can attest to the joy, the camaraderie, and the self-satisfaction that pro bono work brings to the attorneys involved. Pro bono offers a positive impact to the attorneys, so the legal profession as a whole, and of course, to the communities they serve. The second impact of pro bono on the economy. One of the many things that I admire about our legal services is how they incorporate pro bono work within their services. Their volunteer lawyer programs intertwine with their legal services, allowing for the recording of their joint impact. We know how legal aid and pro bono services impact our economy because the monetary benefit of clients has been tracked since 2015. Now, the monetary benefit being the money that legal aid clients are awarded and the money they were able to keep because of the legal help they received. This total, from 2015 through 2021, came to $63.3 million. Million. blows me away. Now it is widely accepted that people with lower incomes circle their money into the communities where they live, and thus they help their local economy. Over $63 million into the local economies across Arizona in just a seven-year time. How does uniting legal aid and pro bono services impact Arizona? Millions and millions of ways. It strengthens our local economies. My third point, which did cause me the most concern, was how pro bono work in Arizona impacts our justice system. I mentioned earlier that our court, our state bar, our legal programs, and the Bar Foundation have access to justice as the number one focus. And I had written that pro bono work is the core of access to justice, that it actually defines it. And then I heard Justice Timmer mention that it would take each of you and all of the attorneys to do 900 hours a year in order to make a dent. But I also remember what I heard from a man in the back of the room who taught me a Hebrew proverb. And he said this evening, if you save one life, you've saved the world. And so I still maintain that pro bono work defines access to justice and therefore our justice system. Their work, your work, gives each of us an equal justice system. Because as we all know, without equal access, there is no justice system. The legal profession, yourselves, the economy, and our justice system are strengthened, enriched, and defined because of your pro bono work, your belief in justice for all. And so for all of Arizona, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ruegg, and thank you to all of you for being here tonight. I'm Ron Flagg, the president of LSC. You will probably not be disappointed to hear that I am the last speaker. I want to thank the Engelman Berger Firm for a generous contribution to help underwrite this event. And my closing words are this. I think about the justice gap a lot. It's been mentioned by almost all of our speakers. And it's clear that given the dimensions of the justice gap, to even make a small dent in it is going to require boldness, leadership, creativity, and collaboration. And I think, as is evident from the speakers tonight and from the people who were our awardees, that all of those traits are in strong evidence here in Arizona, and I hope the work that you are doing and continue to do will serve as a beacon to the rest of our profession and the rest of our country. Thank you for being here, and stay well.